from Warsenal Studio B in Chandler, Arizona, this is MayaCast.
Welcome to another edition of MayaCast. I'm your host, Tom Shadle.
What in the hell just happened from Kit Parcell? No, this is Kit Parcell. That was a Disney character gone wrong.
And this is episode 137 for Friday, June 16th, 2017. Talking about TwinCinity.
I have no idea what's going on right now. I'm losing my mind.
Neither do I, but I know that the people
that was amazing.
The people that listen to this at 1.5 or 2 times speed.
That is good. So good.
Their brains have now melted.
Yeah, it's like you just sucker punched them. You literally just sucker punched them. Brains are now melting through your noses and ears.
So coming up on today's show, I'm going to talk about my experiences last weekend at the TwinFinity Open in the Twin Cities, Minneapolis, St. Paul, Minnesota, and all that kind of good stuff.
That jazz.
We're going to do a libation or two because we are quickly realizing that for our libations contest, if we were to try and do them all in one day, we would be dead.
Yeah. So you're still in running though, right?
So, for sure. Yeah. Still... No, we're gonna keep notes and grades. And but we're going to do some libations along the way and we'll still have more than enough the day of the show.
It's funny that you emailed me and said, hey, we've had this painting competition that's going on for a long time, and we have X amount of entries. But then after one day of the libations, we like quadrupled the entries of our painting competition in one day. So we can screw Tom and Kip up? Let's do it. Sorry, Tom.
That's a good point, Kip. Yeah. Thank you for bringing it up. In the business, we call that a segue.
Yeah.
And not like the Paul Blart segue.
No.
So we have a couple of contests going on that both end at the end of the month. And since this episode comes out on June 16th, you have about 2 weeks left in order to complete your assignments. The MayaCast Master Glass Painting Contest for quarter two is the Alive Crew. Cypher and Switch and Bit with Kiss.
College kids on a mission to ruin the world.
And so, whether you want to convert them or just paint up appropriate models in a unified scheme, or not even unified, but just like maybe unified basing, but they all have their own outfits because they're just, you know, kids doing their thing. You can, we want to see that. And, people have asked, can we use models from other lines? Can we, do conversions? As long as you follow the conversion and proxy rules from the ITS packet, you will be just fine. And so that's going on.
Mm-hmm.
And we are behind schedule on the number of entries as far as the rest of our contests have been. So this is a prime opportunity for you to get in, sweep the competition, get yourself a personalized engraved MayaCast Master Glass, pint glass, with your name on it, or a prime opportunity for a smaller group of entries to be divided amongst the prize pool randomization.
That's very true.
So, I guess this was a tall ask, or people are just, using proxies but not really getting in the model. I don't know. Maybe they're like, well, I probably won't get to use it after this, so why bother? No idea, but there is a low incidence of entries so far. So the picking is ripe, so jump in there and grab your chance. And then we have another contest, which, as Kip mentioned, in 24 hours... quadrupled the number of entries that we already had for the Masterclass. And that is our current libations contest. And this is where you send in drink recipes. And the key will be A, deliciousness, and B, the infinity thematic element.
Yes.
And so as they come in, I've been shopping and collecting ingredients and y'all picking some weird stuff.
We literally had to buy two bottles of this weird juice at the Circle K that's right next door to the restaurant we just ate at.
I had to
Googled it.
Yeah, been to grocery stores and stuff and couldn't find it, and then went to the juice manufacturer's website to see where this particular type of juice would be available. And luckily, they, you know, it wasn't just like put in your zip code and yeah, they have our juices generically. You could put in the exact type of juice you were looking for. And apparently, while not available at any of the grocery stores,
yeah.
It's at every gas station in Phoenix metro area. So, yeah, we've been hunting and collecting the ingredients. And we're going to start early. And we're probably going to start a little bit later tonight with one of the recipes and get started early and take notes and grade and do all that stuff. And because we can't do it all in one day. But, yeah, so what do you win? We have these awesome rocks glasses.
Mm-hmm.
And or for those of you who are teetotalers, and non-alcoholic submissions are more than acceptable, but a juice glass. right?
Yeah.
But yeah, so rocks glasses that are engraved with the awesome hack. Kip, you're yawning into the mic.
I'm sorry.
Everybody
can
hear that. Now everybody else is yawning.
Damn it. It's been a long day.
Man.
Son of a bitch.
Gosh, I only yawn like that when I listen to Remote Presence.
Oh!
So.
Oh!
I just spent all week with those guys, so it's good-natured ribbing.
Yeah, good-natured ribbing,
not
exactly.
Actual internet combat. Yeah, so we got these engraved glasses. And so Tim Tulin from St. Louis area designed this awesome logo that's a cross between the MayaCast logo and the Infinity the hacking circles, like the Minority Report virtual reality pop-up disc circle thingies. And so we've got that. And then around the bottom, it says libations.
Oh, yeah.
So MayaCast libations glasses engraved that are super awesome. So you can win that. And if we get a bajillion entries, we might give out some other prizes. Maybe we'll give out more than one glass if we can't make up our mind. Anyway, so end of the contests is basically what it took me 8 minutes so far to say.
No, they're amazing. Honestly, this was probably my favorite design that Tim sent over. We're on the second of three that he had submitted, and this one just... We didn't know what they were going to look like on a glass. And when they came in, we're like, oh, my. Like, they're amazing. We immediately had to order two as well, just because, you know, like
for our own selves.
Yeah, for our own selves. Yeah. Yeah, it's actually one of the favorite ones of mine to drink from. So you want one of these. They look amazing. Any Infinity fan would love them. Like any Infinity fan. Not just because it's like MayaCast, but it's an Infinity glass. It's their high five to Tim Tulin. That's his Hakazam name, Tim Tulin. Or maybe Yu Ching, I don't know. Let's go.
I have no idea. So, yeah, lots of cool stuff happening, including Arizona Armageddon.
Whoop.
And this is happening the last weekend of September.
It was a hot topic in New Mexico a couple weeks ago.
Oh, was it?
Oh, yeah.
Neat. So it's going to be that weekend from the 29th of September through the 1st of October. It's that last weekend of September. And that is going to be Arizona Armageddon. It's going to be here in Gilbert, Arizona. And at the end of September, could still be 100 degrees. It could be a beautiful 85.
Mm-hmm.
Never know what it's gonna, because last year it was later in October and it was still 100 and it was kind of gross.
I'm scared about that because it's still really not that hot yet.
It's gonna be at our new gaming stomping grounds, Games U in Gilbert, Arizona.
Whoop whoop.
And so keep your eyes peeled because I hope to have registrations going live sometime next week. So as you're hearing this upcoming week. You should be seeing some posts from Arizona Armageddon, the Dire Straits Facebook page saying registration is open and you can sign up. And it's going to be 5 rounds over 2 days. And we've already got Rasmus coming, mm-hmm. who came to Rumble and Frenched out all over Rumble.
Nice.
And so Rasmus is going to make the long trip from Europe. And yeah, so watch for registration to go live. The cap is, I think it was 64 players.
Mm.
And there'll be a there'll be a date, a cutoff date where the price goes up, so you want to get in beforehand. But we will do patches, we will do t-shirts, there's gonna be a ton of swag. We've already got, you know, the outrage with limited edition Knauf. And we've got a fat Yan Yan on deck. We already have some Wotan patches we're gonna hold back for that you could win at Arizona Armageddon. And that's right, Wotan patches. That's a thing.
Yeah.
And I've already got them. And so...
So good.
Lots of cool stuff at Arizona Armageddon. We will... not going to promise anything, but I'm going to ask about maybe it being a satellite tournament to win you entry into the Interplanetario. We'll see how that moves along. But yeah, so that's coming up. Save the date. We've already saved it with the store, so we're all good to go. And so that's coming up. Plus, we have another large Dire Straits type of event coming up that our good friend Will Thompson sent in the information for. And that is happening 2 weeks after Arizona Armageddon. And it is the Iowa Incident Mark IV.
Nice.
Iowa Incident Mark IV will be happening October 14th and 15th. At the Hobby Corner in Iowa City, Iowa. It's going to be 5 rounds over 2 days. Popular format. Monday, June 19th. So this coming Monday, pre-registration starts. It's going to be $45 all the way through August 13th. After that, it's going to be $55. Cost will include individualized swag bags, a meal on Saturday, and as much prize support as... Tim, as Will can muster. There is a 48-player cap for the Iowa Incident. Missions will be determined, of course, once the 2018 ITS season is released after the Interplanetario. Friday, October 13th at night, Beerfinity will be happening. If the budget allows it, Saturday night will be the first Iowa Infinity Krug, modeled after the dining-in traditions of some military units, with our own grog.
Wait, what?
Yeah, I don't know, because I was not in the military. And so, but I'm sure that all of our listeners that are or were know what he's talking about. There'll be a link in our show notes to the Facebook event page. And yeah, so Iowa Incident in Iowa City, Iowa, October 14th and 15th, 2017. Or, if you don't fancy the cold weather, the Arizona Armageddon 2, dropping the deuce.
You know what I like about the fact that we now have a game store that can actually host the tournament that like you had wanted to? The area that it's in is... far more entertaining, I would say. Like within rock's throw, we have a couple of very good restaurants.
Some might call it a stone's throw, but sure.
Stone's throw, yeah. We have lots of restaurants within a stone's throw of every variety. One of the local brews, Beer Research Institute, is right next to the AMC. The AMC that's across the street from there, if like you want to go see a movie after, you know, the first round on Saturday, they serve beer and liquor in that particular movie theater, and all the seats are assigned, so you don't have to wait in line because you have a seat number, and they're all the big reclining chairs, so you guys could like grab your tickets ahead of time, be like, yeah, we're gonna be ending here, go grab some beer in the movie theater, and you don't have to worry about lines if there's a new movie coming out that weekend. If you want to see closer to where I live, it's about a mile and a half from the store. We have Old Town Gilbert, which is like a little strip of bars, restaurants, entertainment facilities. And then another around the corner, we have, you know, our another local brewery, Arizona Wilderness. And then, as always, the good old-fashioned Cornish pasty, which pretty much everybody at the tournament could go and take over the whole restaurant. So lots, like, it's more accessible to really fun stuff to do. So I'm really stoked for people coming out, especially from out of town or out of country, because there's a lot to do, and it's right on the vein of all of what we call the the heart of Arizona's our freeway systems, because everything's off the damn freeway.
So while you were talking, I looked up what movies come out the weekend of September 29th.
Okay.
And learned something. They're remaking Flatliners.
Wait, what?
Comes out September 29th, 2017.
You've got to be kidding me.
Flatliners. Also, a movie called American Made starring Tom Cruise. And a movie called Samson that doesn't even have a poster yet.
I want to talk to Samson.
The week before, though, the Lego Ninjago movie comes out. And the week before, Kingsman comes out. So if you're not keen...
Ooh,
yeah, Kingsman 2.
That is worth a beer in a recliner.
You're not keen to see movies the weekend they come out? Week 2, you could do it here in Arizona.
Hell yeah. So that one right there, I'd be all about.
So, yeah, we're going to do the thing with the stuff, and it's going to be cool. And IO Incident, we'll put link in the show note so you don't miss it. And hopefully, Kip and I will be able to go to IO Incident 2 weeks after Arizona Armageddon.
Will I miss you, buddy?
I was close to going last year, and then that's when Arizona Armageddon fell apart when the when the store closed, and it was a whole thing. And so hopefully this year, now that we have a stable store, we'll, you know, it'll be much easier. So, yeah, things are happening. And we talk about these things because of the amazing times that we have when we go to them. Like Kip last week talking about the Barnaby Backyard Blitz Bonanza Battle.
The Barnaby Bash.
Botanical.
Barnaby, yes.
But yeah,
it was botanical because Joy's backyard is amazing. Great place to be.
Botanical backyard of bruising and boozing,
baby.
Right. So, and what we will talk about next is sort of the same thing, because I went to the Twin Cities in Minneapolis this past weekend and had an amazing time at the TwinFinity Open. Mission debrief. So this weekend I went to Minnesota. I flew out on Thursday night super late because it was a really cheap flight, and I went with my Omer, our good friend Lewis.
He kicks everybody's asses.
And so we flew out, we landed at like 12:30, and then had to get an Uber. And then, oh, thank God Lewis sat in the front, because that dude was chatty. And all I wanted to do was, like, hit the rack and go to bed.
That's funny.
And so Lewis took the bullet there. So we get out there, and it's 2 o'clock before we're ready to turn the lights off, right? You know, take the Uber ride, get our check into the hotel, get, you know, 2 o'clock. Because, you know, it was a good 30 minutes between the airport and the Fantasy Flight Game Center, which the hotel was directly behind the Radisson. And so, yeah, like 2 o'clock, long, long day. We get up the next morning, and Remote Presence picked us up for breakfast.
Nice.
Sean Poschel and Greg Strom. And I haven't seen Greg since the Las Vegas Open 3 years ago, whatever it was. And so it was great to see Greg again. He has grown. his beard and hair even longer than they were before. But yeah, great to see those guys. We went to this crazy place, something about eggs. Somebody's eggs. I don't know.
Somebody's eggs?
Like Ike's eggs. I don't know.
Okay.
Whatever the heck.
Kind of like we have the over easy here.
Waffle dogs. It'd be like Kip's eggs.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
I don't have eggs.
But it was like somebody's name.
Kenzie's eggs.
I don't know. Don't remember. But it was this awesome place. And we went for breakfast. And the breakfast I got was, I don't remember the name of it, but the subtitle was like Lazy Man's Benedict. So welcome.
I just stupid.
Welcome to Minnesota, right? So here's my breakfast.
A lazy man's Benedict?
Yeah.
Like, think about that.
Nope.
Sounds.
So here's my breakfast. It's just, it's a giant platter plate. Not like a round dinner plate, but like the long
or a platter
plate. The platter, those big ones, which is covered in hash browns.
Yes.
All right. On top of the hash browns is a giant grilled cheese sandwich.
What?
Yeah.
Wait a minute.
So grilled cheese sandwich.
Okay.
So lots and lots and lots of cheese.
On top of a...
just gooey, like processed cheese coming out everywhere, all on top of the hash brown base.
This is like my nightmare.
On top of that...
this is my nightmare.
...is their fresh ham.
Oh, right? That's nice. I like
this was not processed ham or that thin, crappy ham or like dry old ham steaks.
It's not Hormel ham.
It was smoked and juicy
nice,
and delicious.
That's
and
good.
So that's on top of the grilled cheese sandwich.
Mm-hmm. Oh.
Yeah.
That sounds delicious.
And then there's...
things are getting better right
then
now.
Then there's a couple... there's a few... there's a couple eggs, you know, over medium.
And, getting better. Loving it.
And then the entire thing. The entire thing. Because you can't see any of that... because the entire thing is covered in hollandaise sauce.
I'll say, are we going on a holiday?
Yeah. So the whole platypus is covered from end to end in hollandaise. And apparently in Minnesota, they don't know that lemon juice is an ingredient in hollandaise sauce. It's still pretty delicious. It's still eggs.
That is like Kenzie's wet dream right there.
Whoa.
Yeah,
whoa.
Seriously. Everything that you just said, like, she is a sucker for like, the Benedict and the hollandaise, and I'm not a fan. Like, it's not my thing.
Oh, really?
No, it's not my thing at all. It's not. Especially when you're like, all the hash browns and the grilled cheese. I'm like, I'm going to be drinking a lot of beer, and that's already bad enough for me. That's, like, the one thing that I splurge on is the beer drinking and the liquor, but... yeah, like if I were, I'm going to go home after this and tell her about that. And she's like, I want to go there.
Yeah.
She will probably go to Iowa Incident just to eat at that restaurant.
So that's nowhere near Minneapolis.
I mean, damn it. I was thinking freaking Will Thompson. So
let me tell you, let me tell you some story. All weekend long with Joel from Remote Presence.
Yeah.
Joel Vaughn. I would tell a stupid joke, and then I would mansplain it, like the Walking Dead meme, you know, where Carl's like, "Dad, stop," and then he repeats the punchline, Coral.
Yeah,
I was like that, so I would explain it real stupid after I would tell it, and every time Joel would be like, "I'm not Kip." You don't need to explain every punchline.
I'm not that much of an idiot, dumbass. Yeah, that was a you, Joel. Anyway, the TwinFinity Open.
No, because I do it all the time on the show.
It's true.
Where I have to explain the references that are just like 10 years older than you would have gotten.
Oh, that is very true.
So,
damn it.
Yeah, don't get them wet after midnight. I don't get them wet at all. Don't feed them after midnight.
Yeah, it's the best.
And
you guys don't even know all damn day.
So that was breakfast. And then we go back to the Fantasy Flight game, Fantasy Flight Games Event Center.
Dude, this sounded like the Disneyland of nerddom, because what you explained to me.
So y'all been down to like the garment district in your city or whatever, and there's like just these super long warehouses, and they're all in rows. Well, there's two of them in a row with all the surrounding parking, and that's Asmodee Distribution.
Asmodee.
Just like Z-Man Games and all the Catan stuff, all the Mayfair Games stuff. And that's one of them, and there's like an auto zone in the front of it.
Nice.
And then the other one is the front of it is the Fantasy Flight Games store. Mm-hmm. It's a retail store. And you walk in, and there's like cafe tables.
Perfect.
A little cafeteria.
Perfect.
And you walk in a little farther, and to your left is a bar, almost reminiscent of like an old-timey ice cream parlor counter. And it's stacked up with games.
More perfect.
Especially like the new releases, like all the new 40K 8th edition index books, right? Are all stacked up back there because they're under guard. But it's an ordering counter because they have a full kitchen. They have beers on tap.
Perfect, perfect, perfect.
And so you can stand in line and order drinks or food or whatever you want. And then to the right is their retail space where they have all of the Fantasy Flight Games products and all the X-Wing stuff and just you know, Game of Thrones, all the stuff. And and the retail area goes beyond where the ordering bar restaurant area is and just retail space. And then once you get past the retail space, then there's room for, I don't know, like 100 people, maybe more. And it's like a board game area with bookshelves all along one wall. And the wall is probably 30, 40 feet long of bookshelves of board games from not just Fantasy Flight, but any company you can imagine that you can pull off the shelf and play at this room for like 100 people.
That's insane.
Or again, like I said, maybe more.
That is insane.
And then to the left of all that was the area we were in where we had 71 players at the TwinFinity Open. And so 71 players, we had 36 tables, I guess, set up. And there was probably room where we could set up another solid 20 more tables. So you could easily fit 120 gamers in there, each at a 4x4 table. Not only that, each at a 4x4 table with a good 18 inches in between each tabletop for you to put your stuff down on and hold your models.
Tokens and your
so you're not
trays.
Even jammed up next to each other.
Oh, man.
So with if you removed all of that space, you could get even more people in there.
Dude, that is the dream. That is the dream.
From what I was told, that was the small game room.
That is the dream.
The small game room. Because the other one holds 250 people or whatever for the X-Wing World competition.
So for this to come to fruition, like, is it because they do distribution and then they have their own game system to where the overhead outweighs the cost of what it is to run the place?
Now, they all of their manufacturing and stuff is there for sure.
Yeah.
Except what gets made in China.
Well, of course.
Right, and I'm sure their design studios are there and all that stuff. Exactly. And they do sell beyond, they sold, 40K stuff, Age of Sigmar stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Games Workshop, there it is. Yeah. Games Workshop stuff. They sold that, and they sold...
GW, Gone with the Wind.
All of the privateer all of the privateer press stuff was half off.
Nice, because it's pee-pee.
It was a giant discount table that said...
Because it's pee-pee.
War Machine and Hordes, 50% off.
Pee-pee.
And so they sell other products other than just Fantasy Flight, although the bulk of it is Fantasy Flight. But I think what keeps them open is not the sales of games. And they're not renting out their space, even for their library.
Mm-hmm.
People can just play games. I think it comes from the sales of, having that kitchen.
Yeah.
And, it's not just like bag of chips or hot dog.
No, a restaurant. Like Card Kingdom. You go in there, it's almost a gourmet meal.
There was...
You would stop in there just to eat and have a beer. Not even just because you're in there playing.
The soup of the day all weekend long was a chilled strawberry soup.
What the hell is that?
And something you get on a cruise ship.
Okay.
Chilled strawberry soup.
Hey, Tom.
Yeah?
Okay.
No.
Okay.
Nope. And...
It's been a while.
like breakfast all day, burritos mm-hmm. and whatever, and they had like different kinds of poutine and burgers and sandwiches and whatever.
Mm-hmm.
But like full kitchen, purportedly really great food, not just like boiled hot dogs yeah. in the cheap grocery store bun kind of thing, right? Yeah. Like good legit stuff. And so selling the food and the drinks and the beers,
yeah,
is probably what funds the front of that.
I could see that.
While the back of it's all the warehouse space is obviously funded by Fantasy Flight's
yeah.
operations itself. So even to the point where like you go up and you, hey, I'd like to buy a bottle of water. And mm-hmm. the staff says, we can do that, but there is free ice water in a dispenser around the corner that you can just get a cup.
That's awesome.
It's like, oh, thank you.
Right.
And condiment counter puts like, even like major chain restaurants that are mm-hmm. nationwide, put the condiment counter puts them to shame because they didn't just have like mustard and ketchup.
Mm-hmm.
They had mayo,
mm-hmm.
relish. They had sriracha.
They had nice, like, okay.
yeah, all kind. They had so simple syrup. They just had a bottle of simple syrup.
What?
Like you want to sweeten your coffee or...
Oh, perfect. Yeah.
You know, I guess mix a cocktail. I don't know. They had simple syrup on the counter in a little squeeze bottle.
No, it's super easy. Like it's literally sugar and water. You just take
right.
10 minutes out of your day.
Right, but
knock
everywhere,
that out.
Everywhere. Like I've never... Like I've... Mm-hmm. You know, you see it behind a bar or yeah. in the kitchen. You never see it just out for anybody to use. Like everybody... Like you usually have to get like sweet and low or
no, it's equal. So perfect.
Right now, just a bottle of simple syrup.
That's actually probably cheaper than the packets of sugar, because you
easier
get
easier to use.
Yeah,
less expensive, tastes better.
Like I said, it takes 10 minutes to melt sugar inside of water.
I have a variety of different flavored simple syrups in my yes. fridge right now.
Easy peasy to make, and honestly, now
also,
that I think about it,
thanks to Sean Poschel, actually. Yeah. gave me his recipes from the ones he brought to Adepticon. So I have a black pepper simple syrup in there, and I have an orange zest simple syrup. They're delicious. Orange zest so good with old fashions.
Oh, yeah. I didn't even think about
garnish
that.
Garnish with an orange peel anyway. And then uh-huh. the black pepper, delicious Sazeracs.
What the hell is a Sazerac?
So a Sazerac is a...
Sounds like something out of the Avengers.
It's a rye whiskey cocktail.
Okay.
So it's like rye whiskey and bitters. Mm-hmm. And so you take a sugar cube, you douse it with Peychaud's bitters mm-hmm. and or orange bitter, like whatever, and you muddle it all up. Mm-hmm. Or you just make a delicious simple syrup and not have to muddle and add okay. a couple dashes of bitters.
Putting down.
And so, you're mixing that with ice, but then in a separate glass, you splash some absinthe in it, swirl it all around to coat it, dump out the excess, fill that with ice, then you pour your rye whiskey, simple syrup, bitters, over your giant ice cube that's in the absinthe-coated glass.
And then all hell breaks loose.
And then garnish it with a...
and then you start hallucinating like you're Pano and Wotan, thinking that you won something when you're faking everything.
With a twist of citrus zest. And so that's a Sazerac.
Okay.
And they're really good. Anyway, we got way off topic.
Yeah, no, let's go back to the Fantasy Flight.
Fantasy Flight. So I get there after breakfast, after eating a grilled cheese ham egg Benedict thing. It's like Eggs Benedict, but instead of a English muffin,
yeah,
grilled cheese sandwich.
It's a bed of Benedict.
And so I get there and we're just there to help Sean, right? Mm-hmm. So unloading the car, unloading the U-Haul, and setting up tables and measuring out objectives on every single table. And they had objectives. They had five objectives for every table that were three-dimensional and full color. They were by
perfect.
They were nice. By Muse on Minis, and I don't know if they're available yet from Muse on Minis or if it was only available at the tournament and they're going to be available later. I have no idea, but I imagine you get five in a pack because every table had five, but super convenient because you don't have to paint them because they're pre-printed MDF.
Oh, nice. That's cool.
So all the edges are, of course, just brown MDF, yeah. but all the surfaces are printed, and so super easy for organizing a massive tournament like this to get all your objectives done. And so we had more mats and more objectives than we had terrain when it first started. So I spent most of the morning. No, but this was just setup day. Mm. So I spent most of the morning measuring out objectives, putting all five, because the first mission is going to be transmission matrix. So I set up transmission matrix objectives.
Some of my faves.
On like 20 tables, you know.
Yeah.
And we set up terrain and we did stuff. I know that Lewis made friends with strangers and played some Wotan games.
Nice.
And I got to speak with the owner of Infinity Harbor for a nice long chat and talk about his, you know, what's going on with him and Infinity and the Infinity accessories. Like Antonosity is no longer having a wholesale program.
So really?
The only way you're going to be able to get Antonosity's Workshop stuff is directly through Antonosity's Workshop in England. So good luck with that shipping.
Yeah.
So apparently all of the Antonosity's Workshop products that I have now are the sum total of what I will own forever. Because I'm not going to pay
that's crazy shipping. So they're not even going through like Warsinal anymore?
No Warsinal, no Infinity Harbor. They're all only going to sell direct. And it was literally like an immediate thing, like, boom, starting now. So like, guess we're done
with that sucks, man.
And then since I do customer service for Warsinal, the whole, you know, ever since then, it's been like, hey, when are you going to get 25 millimeter Lazaretto bases back in stock? Never. Have a nice day.
That's crazy. That's crazy.
So, yeah. So Friday was cool. Set up, hang out, talk, drink their local Minnesota IPA that was on draft.
What is that?
At the game store.
I want that.
It was Surly Brewing Company, and it was the Furious IPA.
Surely I would like a Surly, and I don't want to have it furiously.
So I drank a lot of Surly Furious over the weekend, which...
It just sounds so funny. You're Surly Furious.
A lot of people that know me would be like, well, that's perfect, because that's your personality. You're Surly and you're Furious.
Oh, that's funny.
So, yeah, did that. Not sure where we... I think it was Friday night. Was Friday night an NBA Finals game?
Yes.
Okay, so that's when... That's the night where I was like...
That was
like,
an interesting night for me here, by the way.
So I left Fantasy Flight, and I was like, hey, don't have my iPad, so can't play. Brought my models... Brought my token box, had my tape measure, had everything except my iPad, which has all my... Because it was charging in the hotel. So I was like, I'm going to go back to the hotel, get my iPad, come back, we'll play some Wotan.
Whoa.
So I went to the hotel, and there was a free drink ticket from our room.
Okay, that's cool.
So I grab the ticket, go down to the bar, I get some whiskey... So I get I'm trying to figure out what whiskey she'll give me for this free ticket. Because usually it's just
you don't want to say I want a whiskey.
It's the bottle with the white label that just says whiskey.
Yeah. It's like you're like in an old time Western movie. I want a whiskey, and they just give you whatever the hell they have.
But this was a Radisson.
Okay.
So it was fancy.
Oh, wow.
No, but so I like, can I get Jack Daniels for this? She's like, oh, yeah, of course. I was like, oh, perfect. It's a lot of times, like, they'll stop at Jim Beam, but not right? go all the way
up. All the way to, come on, it's the same thing. Literally the same thing.
So then I want a tipper.
And you want a what?
I want a tipper.
Oh, I thought you'd like.
And so I go into my wallet and I have 20s and 50s.
No.
And so I pull out the 20 and I say, is the best way for me to break this in order to tip you to just make this a double and then just pay for the single?
Ah.
And she thought about it for a second. She's like, yes, actually. Yeah. That'd be great. Perfect. So I made it a double. So I had my double Jack Daniels, and somewhere between the first and second
half. That is called veteran, by the way.
Yeah.
For anybody out there, that is called veterans. That Tom is veteran level 2 when it comes to drink ticket and ordering whiskey.
And so the NBA Finals game is going to start.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm like, oh, I want to watch this because this could be it.
It wasn't.
This could be over. So drinking my whiskey, the game starts. I'm watching the game. I go from whiskey wisely to beer. And then Lewis is like, where are you? I'm like, I'm at the bar. And so he comes and I chat with Lewis, you know, glancing at the game every, you know, couple of minutes, whatever. And so sort of watch the game and hang out and never make it back.
To play some Wotan.
To Fantasy Flight to play any Wotan, because after the beer, then it was like, oh, they've got Lafroig.
Oh, no.
And so I got a Lafroig. And then there was this whole conversation about there's hardly any left in that bottle. You can't pour a full drink. Just put it in the... Zigzagged my way back to the room that night. Anyway.
That's funny.
Nobody cares. They only care about the tournament. Let's talk about the tournament.
No, this is all the stuff that happens. This is why you go out of state for these things. Like, you meet the new people, you go to new places, you have the drinks, and it's the ride, man. It's the ride. It's not the outcome. It is the ride. It's what happens in between, which makes everything better, man. And that's as high as I could sound without ever even smoking weed.
I was challenged in round one by longtime listener, oftentime caller, Rob Bent.
You son of a bitch. Moondog.
The Moondoggy.
The Moondoggy.
So he challenged me to round one.
Get on.
Turns out to be Transmission Matrix. I'm playing Ariadna Kazakh.
Uh-huh.
He's playing Ariadna US.
So
he actually gets a sectorial.
Yeah.
And so Transmission Matrix, all of those hacking, mattered for us.
Yeah, I know. I was just saying, nothing.
All those hacking interactions that are, you know, can be so confusing for people. Yeah, no, didn't matter.
Civil War. This is Civil War.
So hilarious. Moondoggy spanked my ass.
That's horrible, Tom.
He whooped me real good. Fish Called Wanda reference there. And so the score of the game was 8-4. That does not tell the story.
Okay.
What tells the story of my game with Rob are the victory points. The objective points were 8-4.
Mm-hmm.
The victory points were he had 241 remaining.
Ugh.
I had 10.
Gah!
I had the Antipode controller left.
That's it?
She was the only model left on the table, and she's like, fire smoke grenades in at my feet. I don't want to see anything until all the noises stop. No, I'm not going to stop. I'm
oh, my stop. Gosh.
And so he played U.S. Ariadna. He played like 19 orders, 20 models of U.S. Ariadna. And my notes app on my phone apparently wants me to put poo emojis, which is appropriate.
A whole bunch of little chocolate yogurt.
That was funny.
Chocolate ice cream.
Yeah, man. So Rob from the Chicagoland area just whomped me.
19 orders, though.
19 orders of USARF.
Mostly grunts?
At least 9 grunts. 2 or 3 desperados, a maverick, a devil dog, something with like a missile launcher, I think.
Nah.
So that had to be a Minuteman has missile?
Or is yes. Minute. No,
Marauder.
No, Marauders are Rocket.
Minuteman.
Had to be a Minuteman, yeah. One of my new favorite models, by the way.
So, yeah.
Love it. I just licked my microphone saying love it.
So, he couldn't fail an armor roll, man.
That's some BS.
He had 4 grunts with the heavy flamethrower and light shotgun, not the infiltrators, just regular. And just like, linked them up. And started moving them across the center.
Wait, did they start linked? No. You just said they linked them up.
No, he started his link on his 4 sniper, 1 HMG link team.
That's brutal. Wait, Rob, who had first turn?
He did.
Did he know he had first turn?
Yeah, he chose it.
Rob, I'm yelling at you right now. Why the hell do you start your link in something that you're not going to go for? Like, maybe did he could have thought, like, maybe I'm going to start defensively in case you start here and then I'll move. Don't waste a command token.
Maybe
switch instinct. Why'd you waste a command token if you knew you're going to just Rambo up your other dudes?
Maybe he thought, because he had to deploy first.
Yeah.
Maybe he thought, like, there will be certain pieces I will need to remove that my snipers will be best suited for in that link team. And then I'll switch later. And then the way he set up his team and where I set my models, he couldn't see anything to shoot, so had to immediately switch to his grunt assault.
So my advice to Rob, because the Moondoggy is one of our longest listeners and good friends, put your fire team up there and then make your flamethrower grunts your main guys, because that could goat people into being like, well, now I will deploy where they can see me, because most of the time nobody's gonna deploy where they can see your snipers, dude. You get the first turn. Like, deploy that way, because you could goat them into then switching and making that command token worth it.
So he started with it on the
sniper. Some advice.
4 snipers and an HMG grunt team, and he immediately switched it to the 4 heavy flamethrowers. And so this is the point. They started marching across the table, and they're 4-2.
Yeah, they don't move fast.
And so I was AROing with scouts with the Oatniks, the Spetsnaz with sniper rifle, right? Mm-hmm. And taking arrows, because they're moving across, they're not in cover, and he's not dodging or firing back. He's moving because they're 4-2. And he made every armor save on that slog across the middle of dead no man's land. You know, he had some desperado smoke that denied an arrow or two here or there, but he was, you know, getting shot at with Oyotniks on 15s and Spetsnaz sniper on 15s, and just plinked every armor. Boink, boink, beep, beep, bonk. Their armor 3, their armor 2 to the scouts, because the Oyotniks are AP. They just walked across, didn't care, kept moving, kept coming. And then he was...
Go, go, go.
Then he was in my deployment zone. And after like 6 orders of taking arrows. And he's in my deployment zone, and now there was no vertical terrain. It was all horizontal.
So once
he got, and there really wasn't enough terrain, and it was kind of centralized, so there's not a lot in the deployment zones, right?
So once
he gets to me, there's nowhere to hide. That you couldn't go into any of the buildings. Like, none of them had interiors. And there was just, you know, there was no vertical terrain. It was all horizontal elements, and there was hardly any scatter at all, like 4 low walls. 2 on each deployment zone. And so there's nowhere to hide. I'm prone behind stuff. But it doesn't matter once you get past it and can turn left and right and just start blasting stuff. So, cool. If I dodge, light shotgun. Make it a face-to-face. If I shoot back, sweet. Heavy flamethrower. Don't care if I die. Probably will make my armor. And you take an automatic flamethrower.
Yeah.
And so it was just, death,
Yeah, that's pretty brutal.
And ran his devil dog up, who I did not get a lot of arrows because he used the desperado smoke pretty well. And not sure any desperados made it past turn one.
I wouldn't imagine. But
anyway, gets the devil dog all the way up and charges the Spetsnaz sniper in turn, I think it was turn two.
Okay.
Easy mistake to make, because you think, I have this close combat beast in the, you know, it's, you use the antipode first, and then when that died, had to send the devil dog.
So your Spetsnaz was like, stab, antipode, dead.
No, it makes sense. Like, you're like, oh, he's a sniper. He's a camo guy, sniper. He's going to be super crunchy in close combat. Nah, man, he's a Spetsnaz. Spetsnaz will kill you.
Where are they close combat, like 20?
Close combat, 20, martial arts 2.
Nice. That works.
They will screw you up. And the Anapos don't have close combat.
No.
They're just Devil torn. Dog doesn't have close combat. I mean, close combat. Doesn't have martial arts.
Martial arts, yeah.
And so gets the antipode up, and I shank it.
Yeah, -3 to you.
Gets the Devil Dog up.
-3 to you.
Shank it for a wound.
Mm-hmm.
And he immediately stops spending orders on it.
It's like, damn, I don't know they're that good.
So it's transmission matrix. The sniper's where he needs to be to score the zone, but I have the Devil Dog there,
mm-hmm.
which is, and then two grunts are still alive. This is like turn three now.
Mm-hmm.
And so I need to remove the Devil Dog if I want to claim my front left quadrant. And with a score 8-4, we tied the first two turns.
That's
even true. Though I'm dying and dying and dying, I have the second turn, so I'm able to move stuff into position
and
to at least
score, yeah.
Score an equal number, you know. Anyway, it's my third turn. It's the bottom of three. I need to score this zone. The only way I'm going to do it is by killing this Devil Dog.
Mm-hmm.
And Spetsnaz has pretty good luck, but he had advanced that sniper heavy machine gun link team.
Oh.
And they can see the close... Some of them can see the close combat. I think three of the models could. And one of them had died at that point, so it was a four-man link. And so I go to shank the Devil Dog in close combat. His ARO with the Devil Dog is close combat.
Yeah.
And then he's like, and the link team's going to also... everybody that can see is going to fire into the combat.
Pretty smart.
Because, yeah, totally smart. Because he's like, Devil Dog's probably dead anyway, the way these combats have been going. And if I kill my own dude, whatever, but I need the Spetsnaz to die.
Mm-hmm.
And he needs twos. Because, you know, +3 for range, -3 for camo, -3 for cover, -6 for close combat. It's -12, but +3 range is -9. Yeah, he needs twos. And so I shank the Devil Dog, make it unconscious. Now he rolls all of his stuff, and he murders the rest of his dog, blows it into tiny little bits.
Yeah, he missed everything except for one.
Rolls like a lot of fours and fives. I'm like, oh, all those, bah, you know, killing the dog. And he rolled one single one. And that one hits.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, I failed my armor because I did not make an armor save this game.
Ugh.
In fact, I did not make armor saves in most of my games.
That is a crap.
But yes, I killed the Devil Dog, but he rolled that 1-1 on a sniper rifle, failed the armor roll, off the table with the Spetsnaz, no scoring. He still has two grunts right there, which I easily outscore if I stay alive. So good job from him. Anyway, so
I agree with that, though. I would have crit mined on that. I was like, I'm shooting for twos. Maybe that 1-1.
Yep.
Yeah.
Totally. No, great move. It was 8-4, but like I said, the minor victory doesn't tell the story of the 241-10. Game two was against Jinja Ninja, which is one of the best ITS nicknames. The only one I can think of that's better is Yo James Bo.
Yep.
Because that's a great name. His name was John, and he was redheaded. He had a beard and a mustache. And he played Yujing, Vanilla Yujing. And he had a Yanhuo Neurosynetics 2 missile launcher, dude. And he had a Xian.
That's a thing?
Yeah.
How did I miss that, playing Yujing this Escalation League?
Because... And so, yeah, Yanhuo with two missile launcher neurocinetics.
Yep.
We've even argued about it on the show with the ruling of the neurocinetics and how it twin weapons only works in the active turn and how people are being pedantic and not getting the point. Yeah.
Right.
So he had that. Okay. And he had a Xian HMG.
Okay.
And there was like a total reaction bot. There were four monks. There was a Guilang. I don't know. Stuff. And, wish I could remember what mission we were playing. But I didn't decide to put that in my notes, apparently.
Okay.
But.
Was that a bad day then?
What I knew was that the two things I wanted dead were the Yanhuo.
Yes.
And the Xian.
Yes.
Because I don't need a Shein with all my camo markers
blowing
stuff up. And so, obviously, the Shein was the antipode target.
I was just saying, you want to eat the Shein?
Yeah. So I sent the antipodes, and they went to go eat the Shein. And didn't kill it on his turn, but then didn't spend any more orders on the antipodes.
Mm.
Just left in base contact. Well, you know, finish it on his turn. Took out the Yanhuo right away.
Really? With what?
Surprise attacking tank hunter APHMG.
Hell yes. Are you kidding me?
Yeah.
That works.
Tank hunter APHMG surprise attack. Murder the Yanhuo. Yeah. So it went unconscious. It was all in his backfield. He's a newer player. And so like the tank hunter, you know, it's like the tank hunter is going to like either move to here or idle or whatever I said. Right. And he says, Yanhuo will discover.
Ooh.
And I stood back and I shook my head. No, really fast. He's like, what? No. I was like, no. So I've put him in a place where he's about to be super aggressive. Remember that you can always hold your arrow against a camo marker. If you decide to hold and all I do is move, you're going to lose your ARO. But if it really seems like I'm about to attack you, it will allow you to attack me back.
Yeah.
And, you know, I was like, no, don't do that.
Yeah.
Don't do that. Don't do that. He's like, oh, okay, then I will hold. I was like, yeah, I'm going to reveal Tank Hunter APHMG and surprise shoot you. He's like, oh, okay, I'll shoot back.
Yeah, exactly.
So, and it just didn't go his way. And so
he was
a super nice kid, man.
Mm-hmm.
I say kid, he's probably 27.
Oh, yeah.
And
young adult.
But I'm old.
Young adult at that point.
Super nice guy. He could have easily gone on tilt at any point because his stuff just got murdered a lot. And yeah, so I won 9-3, I think, or 9-1, or something like that. Don't quite remember. But super nice guy. And I actually crit in this game.
Holy crap.
I remember it because I said, oh, I'm sorry, man. Because it already wasn't going his way.
Mm-hmm.
I was like, oh, I'm sorry, I crit. And he's like, oh, this is like yesterday when Lewis crit me 15 times.
That, hey, what was it? Ginger Ninja? That's every day in Lewis's life.
Well, and I was like, oh my God, that was you? Lewis told me that story.
He crit 15 times.
I didn't realize that was you.
It's like Tom Winters all over again.
In a Wotan game. So, yeah. Ugh.
That's horrible, man.
Poor dude. And then I felt,
why did he play Lewis if he's new?
That was just like friendly game
I think
Lewis was just trying to make friends, or maybe the guy was like, do you want to play
Lewis again? Doesn't make friends in other places. He makes mortal
corpses,
enemies.
Yeah. That's not true. Everybody loves Lewis.
I agree with that statement. He's a really good guy.
And then I felt super bad for John because just before the fifth round started, he's like, all right, good luck. You know, nice to meet you. Good game. And I was like, what are you doing? Are you quitting? He's like, no, I got the bye. He got the final round bye.
Oh.
I was like, oh, that's terrible. But he was, that's terrible. But he was a local.
Oh, that makes sense then.
So at least it wasn't somebody from out of town that had to eat the bye.
Yeah, that and all the money. You would never want to do that. Yeah. Do not do that.
So John was awesome. And so I should have prefaced the entire thing by saying I could not have asked for five better opponents. Everybody I played was jovial,
okay,
jocular, just a real pleasure to play, man. Just everybody was upbeat and fun, and so it was great. Even though I was getting my teeth kicked in.
Damn, Tom.
Everyone, you know, I had a good time because everyone was super great. So game three, I played Tom. I was like, walked up to the table, I'm like, Tom, He said, Tom. I said, Doctor. He said, Doctor. And that went on for a while. And then I knew we were going to have a great game.
That's hilarious.
So he's from Minnesota as well. He's got jokes just like we do.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what we did all game, was tell jokes. I bought him a beer. Oh, let me tell you about how I bought him a beer.
Okay.
Can't believe this worked. And didn't mean it to. I was just trying to be funny. But this is how nice Sean Poschel is. We're like doing turn one. And I see Poschel walking by. He's real close. And so I yell, Judge! Like in the jerkiest voice I could.
Yeah.
Right? And he gets the judge look on his face. And he comes over. He's like, yeah? I was like, I am out of beer.
That is so good.
And because Sean's Sean, he's like, oh, I'm about to get myself a soda. Do you want something? And so I got money out of my pocket, and I'm like, yeah, I'll have a Furious. He's like, yeah, I'll get that for you. No problem.
Oh, that's so good.
And it's doubly funny.
That's so good. Judge.
Yeah. Doubly funny.
Like a beer on this table.
Doubly funny because every game I had, Joel Vaughn approached me and was like, hey man, do you need anything to drink? Are you doing okay? Is there anything I can get? And every time he came over, I was like, no, I'm really good right now. Thank you very much for asking. And so Poschel goes to get us beer. Vaughn comes over a few minutes later. He's like, really? Really? I can't do anything for you. But Sean can get you. And then Tom wanted a beer, so I got Tom's beer. So yeah, bought us beer. We had beer. We had jokes. We had a good game. And Tom, again, could have gone on tilt through his first turn because everything was going my way.
Mm-hmm.
And then that was the first half. And then the second half of the game, everything went his way.
Uh-oh.
So perfectly balanced. Except I'd much rather have the second half go right my way than the first. And I lost to him 7-3. Again, I don't remember the mission. So whatever. Don't remember the mission, but I lost 7-3. And I had it the whole way. And then just... His dice got hot, my dice got cold, and the one thing I remember about that game is I always had like this extra order or two in a secondary pool that I had nothing to do with. And I'm like, oh, I got the 112. I can move him around to a more relevant position.
Okay.
Instead of just letting him sit there where he's safe.
Mm-hmm.
And so I move him around this building one turn, I move this around the building second turn, and then his third turn, he's able to move to a position where he can murder the doctor, and he does. And it's at that moment that if I had left the doctor in his original position and burnt the orders, not even spent them.
Yes.
Because there's nobody I can put in suppressive.
Yeah.
And if I do anything else, I'm going to overextend myself. Right? So if I just leave the doctor where he's at, he's in range of two orders, which he has in his pool, to go heal an unconscious person from safety and get one of my classifieds.
Oh, no.
But instead, I was like, I've got the orders. I feel like I should use them. So I move him around so he's closer to like where the action is.
Yeah.
And I got him murdered.
Come on. Oh.
So, well, and it was like, there's nobody coming this way. But then he had the orders to sweep around and draw a bead. So, yeah, that was all on me.
I just crushed my headphones.
Tom was great. I wish Tom was part of our local group.
Nice.
With the jokes and the banter. So one of the things we had to do at the tournament was at the end of the thing, we had to vote for a People's Choice Army Award.
Okay.
Like, which army list or paint job did you see that you want to take home with you because it was that awesome?
Cool. That's awesome.
And, you know, so walked around and looked at all the different ones and picked one. And then the other thing we had to vote for was, who was your favorite opponent of the weekend?
Okay.
And I chose Tom. And Rob was awesome, right?
Mm-hmm.
And always great to play Moondoggy. And Ginger Ninja was awesome.
Mm-hmm.
You know, newer player who didn't get salty at all. And my last two games on the second day, also super awesome guys. And we'll talk about them in a minute, right?
Mm-hmm.
But Tom, even though I lost, even though the dice abandoned me in the second half of the game, and everything I tried to do failed, and everything he tried to do succeeded, right? And he pulled victory out of the jaws of defeat or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
It was just the banter and the jokes and the references and the all the stuff. And so I had a great time playing Tom. So he got my vote for best opponent, although
nice.
I literally could have given it to all of them.
That's good. That's a good choice to have to make.
I decided to go with the guy whose name was Tom. No, that's not why I did it.
I had a quote today that was saying, like, hard choices make for an easy and good life. Easy choices make for a hard and a really bad life. So having that...
Very interesting sentiment I'd need to stew on.
Yeah, well, that. You have a hard choice because you have so many good things. You had to choose the best of the of all of this goodness, yeah.
They are all amazing.
Mm-hmm.
So that brings us to the end of day one,
mm-hmm.
where at the end of day one, we wanted to have a... Hey!
That was so good! At the end of day one, we had a veto.
Everybody and say hello to Thor.
Thor.
Who wanted to be on the show because, you
Way
know...
Way to go, dogs.
He's got some congestive heart failure. So,
I don't even want to think about
it. So who knows how long old daddy Thor is going to be around. Vino's super confused because he has no idea what the barking's for.
Yeah, he has a Darth Vader chew toy in
the
his
son.
Mouth.
And yeah. So, so we wanted to have a quieter dinner where we could, like, discuss Infinity things quietly. And so Lewis and I went out with Sean Poschel. And Joel Vaughn from Remote Presence, Sean also of running all of TwinFinity, and Mark Monlapis, who runs the Com Log, which is an awesome blog. He's from Atlanta. He's running the Southeast Slam that's coming up soon.
Hotland.
So if there it is.
Yeah.
So if you're in the Southeast, and you check out the Southeast Slam because that's coming up soon. Anyway. So we went out to a place called Nighthawks.
Oh, are you kidding me right now?
And it's
are you kidding me?
It's
Nighthawk.
Totally, yeah. My
Gal Rail sniper. You went to Nighthawks.
We went to Nighthawks. And
that's so good.
It's totally my kind of place.
Of course it is, because it's Nighthawks.
It was a local joint that you know, everything is made from scratch.
Perfect.
And it's sort of a, you know, it's sort of bar food, but elevated, sort of somewhere between bar food and diner food, but elevated.
It's perfect for
that
time,
like,
of night.
I don't know, 30 beers on tap.
Hell yeah.
And a lot of them were local.
Perfect.
And so he could not have chosen a better place. And so I thank him for that because it was awesome. And went out, had dinner, and, you know... Talked, and I think that was the time where, because how did Joel describe me after Adepticon? Something about my acerbic wit.
That's
because okay. I am not exactly the same in person as I am on the show.
Who says that?
I don't know. I'm a giant dick. Anyway,
not even
so. The banter back and forth and. Joel's like, why are you always insulting me? Or like, why are you so mean to me? Or whatever.
Because they just don't know your sense of humor.
Meanwhile,
they don't know your sense of humor.
No, no, no. Meanwhile, Joel is even more acerbic. And so at one point I got to say, because he said something to me, and I was like, he says that and then asks why I'm so mean to him. No, it was great. It was a great dinner. And
so you needed the balance of me.
At the perfect place. And I was hoping to get back and play a Wotan game with Will Thompson, who's running the IO Incident that we announced at the beginning of the show.
That I always just
And by the time we got back, we'd played three games all day and then went out to dinner. And then it's, 10 o'clock at night and I'm old.
Yeah, no.
And I was like, you know what I'd really like to do is get a drink from the bar, go up to the hotel room and sort of like just crash out. So I Facebook messaged Will and I was like, hey, man, I'm not going to make it back for a game. And he's like, I am crashing out. And he responded. He's like, yeah, I'm crashing too. Totally cool.
You know what's funny about that, Tom, is, and you can attest to this, if we're out of town and there's a lot of people that I don't see a lot, when I go to the bar and grab a beer to relax, instead of making the smart decision like you and Will to go to bed because you got to go up, I just go, let's go, let's go, yeah, let's go. And then 3 o'clock happens, you're like, what did I do?
I picked up the beer to take back to the room, and for the second night in a row, didn't even finish it.
Oh, man.
And we did introduce Mark, because Mark was in our room with me and Lewis.
Oh, nice, that's cool.
And so we introduced Mark to Space Team.
Oh, okay.
Defibrillate the hydrocapacitor. Yeah, that whole game.
Yeah. So, I was so drunk the first time we played that, because again,
if you don't know Space Team,
oh man,
and you've got a bunch of friends that are on the same platform, either iOS or Android. Android players can't play with iOS and vice versa. You all need to play on the same platform, but go get it, especially if you're a fan of Star Trek and all the nonsense that they would shout out during space battles.
So good.
You have to coordinate and get through. Anyway,
we did that in New Mexico, and
you played Space Team in New Mexico.
Yeah, isn't that the first time I played it? Because I was like really drunk.
Oh, so you're not talking about like 2 weeks ago?
No, like when we went
back when we went on the
Rumble.
Trip.
Yeah,
sure, for sure,
yeah,
for
yeah,
sure.
Yeah. When I did the climbing plus,
we totally did.
I did the climbing plus. Yeah,
Space Team. And so, thank you, Willis. Willis. Thank you,
Willis. What you talking about? What you talking about, Willis?
Now I'm picturing Lewis with a giant, great, big, black Greek beard, like Willet. And so that was a fun time. Thank you, Lewis, for introducing us all to Space Team.
Mm-hmm.
Now that wraps up day one. So before we get into day two, let us begin our libations contest journey.
What?
Yeah. To lock them, burst your filthy mug. If you draw one more shocking,
yeah! Libations are everybody.
All right, so the first of our entries, and I don't think it was the first one, it's just the first one we've tried.
Yeah, because we picked up the tropical simple.
Yeah, we couldn't find the juice.
Ever.
And then we found the juice. We got excited.
Circle damn K.
Comes to us from Andrew Har.
Har.
And no, there's more A's. There's only one R. There we go. Yeah.
There you go.
And yeah, so it's called the Paradiso Punch.
Okay. I would call it the Paradiso Peach.
Well, it's called the Paradiso Punch. And it's very simple. You only need two ingredients, although one I had to Google to find.
Right.
You only need two ingredients.
Go to Circle K.
It is one part Crown Royal Apple.
Mm-hmm.
And it is two parts Simple Tropical, which is the thing I couldn't find.
Yeah, you think it'd be simple enough, right?
Simple Orange everywhere.
Yeah, Simple Lemonade.
Or
Simply Limeade. Yeah, Simply Tropical.
That's the one at the
Circle K.
Yeah. At the gas station.
Little bottles.
So two parts Simply Tropical, one part Crown Royal Apple.
Hmm.
And he says it's super fruity, easy to drink, and worth starting Black Ops War or two over. And it's approved by his nerdy wife.
So.
And so I sipped it before we even cheersed.
We can do a cheers while we're talking.
Clinked.
Here. There you go.
Before we even did that, I sipped it and Kip called me a name because I didn't follow proper etiquette.
I was like, come on, man.
And he's like, how is it? I was like, oh my God, it's freaking delicious.
It is. to me, it tastes like a peach Starburst, which doesn't even exist that I know of. It doesn't even, but that's what it tastes like.
The Crown Apple plays off of that Simply Tropical juice really, really well. We are, you know, we're going to take notes. We're gonna give this a high really mark.
Good. This is very good.
And for flavor.
Mixing wise, though, for you guys, there were no instructions.
Mm,
so true. Going off of Tom and I's extensive research into how to properly consume alcohol, we did a shaker. I did a shaker. And then the top of the shaker is usually about an ounce and a quarter. So since we're mixing two drinks, so two of those, so 2.5 ounces of the crown. And then four of those, which comes out to 5 ounces of the Simply Tropical, into a shaker with ice. I shook it till my hands froze, because that's what you do when you're doing a shaker, over the shoulder. Hard down to get everything to muddle at the bottom. I filled 2 MayaCast Libation size glasses.
Rocks glasses, yeah.
With ice, and then strained over. It was a perfect amount for 2 people. Came out ice cold, perfectly mixed. And like I said, it tastes like a peach Starburst. I don't know, apple converts to peaches. But millions of peaches.
Peaches for free.
Yeah.
No, it's delicious. Andrew, thank you very much for sending in the thing.
Oh, it's so good.
Another...
this is ridiculous. This is damn ridiculous.
That is sitting out by the pool.
Oh, yeah.
Watching TV, because I can do that.
Yeah.
Kind of beverage when it's hot out.
This is Arizona summer drink right
here. Let me tell you what happened at TwinFinity, though, since it's the TwinFinity episode. Is so Moondoggy, who I played in the first round.
That son of a bitch.
Where he waxed my ass.
Thank him, by the way, for his entry was amazing.
That's what I'm about to tell you about.
Yeah, okay.
He's like, okay, so we're outside the event center, you know, in like a drum circle talking. And he says, hey, I have my entry for your libations contest. And he starts like... digging into his pocket, and I'm like, oh my god, don't give me a piece of paper, I'm gonna lose it. I don't want a grubby piece of paper with I don't want a pirate treasure map of your recipe that I'm gonna lose, and it's gonna be, oh, digging out of his pocket. He pulls out his wallet and he hands me 2 $50 bills.
Oh shit.
It's like, what are you talking about? He's like, no here's the thing. I was like, no, you're crazy. He's like, shut up, listen, it's going to be perfect because Kip won't be able to do it. And so it's going to be humiliating.
Oh, so good.
It's like, you take this money and you go to the liquor store and you buy the best bottle of whiskey that you like.
Okay. With $100?
With $100. And
for you, that'd be like the peediest rubber, right? Fucking
and he said,
explicit now.
Yeah.
Eraser tasting. Sorry, that's how much I can't stand
scotch.
Peaty scotch. Like, so, I literally dropped an F-bomb because I cannot stand it.
Buy the best whiskey that you can.
Ugh.
Put a couple of rocks in a glass, pour it over the rocks, and drink it. And... it's going to be humiliating because Kip won't be able to do it. And you call it the Van Zant.
Because
he doesn't... it's just straight whiskey.
I can do whiskey. I just can't do like the that eraser-tasting scotch that you guys drink.
And so I've got these $250 bills in my hand that I don't know how to react to. I'm like, no, Rob, no, that was ridiculous. It's like, no, that's my entry. And if there's money left over... you go buy the ingredients that you need for the rest of these cocktails.
Can I say something? Can I interject? So, I know we were like, hey, if we get enough entries, we get 2 winners. And before I say this, nobody else try to buy your way to a glass because it won't happen. This was one of those instances where somebody was completely creative out of nowhere. Rob, I'm voting right now, he already just won a glass. he just won a glass for creativity.
Here's the thing.
He won creativity.
Because it's exactly what you're saying is
yeah.
you can't buy your way into
you
a
can't.
Glass.
No.
So we can't say that.
You know, it's for creativity.
We can express our appreciation.
Yes.
Especially, and it's not our place to talk about it.
Okay.
He has had the shittiest year out of shittiest years.
Really?
And my heart goes out to him for all he's had to deal with.
I don't know what he's had to deal with. But I want to give him, I think that he is one of my creative, it's just like the Batman.
To put a bow on it, things are looking up for him. He's just put earnest money on a new place.
Mm-hmm.
So he's buying a place. So things are pointing in the right direction. But he has had a crummy, crummy year. And so I'm glad we almost didn't even see him at Adepticon. I'm glad we did.
Mm-hmm.
I was just like, what am I supposed to do? How am I supposed to react to this?
Well, I'm going to react for us. I literally want to just, for creativity, like we always do that. Like if somebody goes outside of the box, I think it's cool. And I'm not saying this is going to happen, but it just, for me, outside of the box thinking like that.
No, I get it. You're overwhelmed by his generosity.
Yeah. But then like the Van Sant and the Kip and blah, blah, blah. Like when something strikes me that way, and I know that like in other contests, people try and it's like, yeah, that was cool. We can't do it all the time. But in this, I don't know.
No one
blew me away.
No one send money.
Yeah, nobody ever do. That's what I'm saying. Nobody do this ever again. Please do not do this ever again. But it was super creative on his side. Like, everything was perfect.
The best part was like, and I know Kip won't be able to drink it.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Like, it was so perfect. Like,
so it'll be humiliating. It'll be great.
So good. I want to deter people from just being like, sending us hundreds of, I would rather, you know, like the creativity part of it is like, is what we are going for. It's all about the creativity. That's creative, man. Like,
it's definitely, yeah, it's definitely knowing
it's,
you.
It's, well, it's totally out of the realm of what we, of possibilities. So I kind of was like, I kind of want to give him the runner up. It's not going to win. But I want to give him the creativity award.
Way too early.
It is way too early.
There's still
way too early.
2 weeks
worth. But
2 weeks worth of submissions. Anyway.
Yeah, Rob, just don't expect anything, but you're runner-up for me right now for creativity. Insane. That was awesome.
Yeah, insane is correct. Right, so let us know.
But we love you.
I'm not going to play the whole. Yeah, and
wholeheartedly love
you. My heart goes out to you for all you've had to deal with. I'm not going to play the whole thing again, but let's get into the whole bumper thing.
Well, damn it.
He rolled a crit.
You're not going to play that?
Let's get into day two.
Okay.
Games.
Can we just play the male bumper then if you're not going to play that?
No.
Okay.
Day two of games at the TwinFinity Open. So that brings us to day two, and the day started where I was teamed up?
Matched up.
Against Toha. I'm like, I hate playing against Toha. But I was matched up against Grant Fetter.
Okay. That's a good one.
He was one of my booth babes at Adepticon. He's going to be a booth babe at Gen Con. And he's one of the hosts of the Personal Flash Paper podcast. And so he was there. And he works for the same company my wife does.
Really?
Yeah.
Didn't know that. That's cool.
And I never mentioned Game 3. Tom played Capocalki. Anyway. So I'm playing Toha against Grant Fetter. And it's highly classified.
What does that mean? Can I know that?
You can. It's the mission.
I'm joking.
And so I'm playing Ariadna. He's playing Toha. It's highly classified. Those are the two factions that when people talk about highly classified, mm-hmm. they're like, oh, it's hard on those guys. And yeah, because the lack of slave drones.
Oh, okay, yes, I could see that.
The lack of structure, or the So anyway, so we're playing Highly Classified.
Okay.
And it's a great game, and he's a great guy. Buy him a coffee, because I'm getting a coffee, mm-hmm. so get him a coffee as well. And so great time, great way to start the day. Playing against Grant, and he's playing his Toha. I'm playing my Kazakhs, and it's back and forth. And I get three out of the four main regular classifieds, plus I get my secret one. He gets the same three out of the four, plus his secret one. And so we're tied.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's the bottom of three. And you can protect, like, you got to protect your HVT in case they have HVT ones.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah.
And you can do that all you want. But McCall's have zero V smoke.
Oh, yeah.
And if you're playing an opponent that knows how to maneuver a McCall so they don't get shot,
mm-hmm.
and then throws smoke in an area to block vision, you know, there's no consequence. There's no way to counter it. And then they can just walk up and do what they want. So you can protect mm-hmm. your stuff as much as you want, but line of fire is the thing you need. And eclipse smoke, you don't get it.
Nope.
And so, yeah, Toha's pretty good. And so we all get our objectives, and it's my turn three, and we start my turn three, and I've got eight orders. Well, I have seven orders, plus an irregular, plus I have a command token, so I could have eight if I wanted eight. And the only one that I'm missing, that he's missing as well, we're both missing the same one, and it's Test Run.
Oh, okay.
Neither one of us got it. And I have eight orders. I do have a Katyusha. I do have a Minesweeper Tractor Mule. Mm-hmm. And in between the deployment of both of them, I have a Dozer.
Nice.
And they are both touching they're on the ground floor. They're touching the wall of a building.
Mm-hmm.
So I have eight orders. According to the rules,
mm-hmm.
I could climb the building,
mm-hmm.
jump off the building.
I hate that.
And
so dumb.
Hope I fail one or two armor rolls, but not three.
Mm-hmm.
Then have my dozer move over, fix the remote,
mm-hmm.
get test run, and win the scenario.
I'm going to interject really quick. The reason I don't like this is you're playing a two-player interactive strategy game. If you want to do that, play solitaire, because that's all you're doing. You're playing against yourself. And those out there, they're like, well, that's the rules, and it's blah, blah, blah. I know that it's written in there that you can do that, but you're not playing against your opponent, so that's solitaire. Go play solitaire to where I've even seen people cheat at that to win. And if you cheat yourself, then you really have a problem. But so, that's just my personal opinion. Just throwing it out there.
So I have eight orders. I mm-hmm. have two tractor mules. I could climb and jump. Mm-hmm. And get test run and win the scenario.
Mm-hmm.
But that, and it's totally legal given the rules as written.
As written.
And I didn't do it. Instead, I spent most of those orders on my Spetsnaz with HMG. And I ran around and I killed a whole bunch of Toha dudes.
Mm-hmm.
To get more, you know, to get more victory points than he did.
Oh, okay.
Meanwhile, I know we're going to tie on objective points 7-7.
Mm-hmm.
So everything in the rules is, most of the things in the rules, let's put it that, most of the things in the rules are designed to prevent you from harming your own troops. You cannot just attack your own troop.
Mm-hmm.
You may, so there are exceptions. Like biolocator,
mm-hmm.
you can blow up a Quang Shi's head because that's what they're designed for. That's in mm-hmm. the story, right? They're convicts. We've lobotomized them and put explosives in there, and you know that's mm-hmm. that's what they are. You're allowed to shoot into close combat, and the thinking there is probably like, well, I'm going to shoot the enemy. And, oh my God. Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to. Here, Fusilier Angus.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I didn't mean to shoot you by Pandra. I'm so sorry. Right? And so you can hurt your own troop that way.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, if you fire a blast template and it affects a friendly model, the shot is negated.
Mm-hmm.
You may not target your own models for an offensive attack.
Mm-hmm.
You know? And which is super important because I can't run out a 5-point mutt near a camo marker,
mm-hmm.
run a Nafatoon behind the 5-point mutt, flamethrow the mutt with the Nafatoon, and catch the enemy camo marker in the flamethrower.
Yeah, exactly.
Right.
Yeah.
So it's super important that it's there.
Yeah.
But all, you know, most of the stuff that's in there is designed like you cannot hurt your own troops.
Mm-hmm.
Also, for me, games tell a story,
mm-hmm.
and you know. Well, the rules say you can do it. Well, it's the only way you can get. If they're not going to shoot your remote, that's the only way you can get the objective. And all I want to say is like, so write me the story. Tell me the narrative,
mm-hmm.
and write me a story and suspend my disbelief and make that legitimate,
mm-hmm.
like so that I can believe why this tank went up a wall, flipped over backwards, crushed its turret, and had the engineer go over and fix it.
Mm-hmm.
Because High Command said, you know what? You should really work on fixing things during this mission. And it's idiotic, and it's stupid, and
yeah,
it breaks the narrative. And yes, it's legal by the rules. The way one person put it to me was, yeah, so if you want to win, you do it. And if you don't want to win, you don't. Like, no.
That's a double-edged sword.
I felt better,
mm-hmm.
about knowing that I had a tie,
mm-hmm.
and playing to that tie, mm-hmm. and just running around and murdering stuff. I felt way better about that than I would have if I would have drove a tank,
yeah.
up a wall and then jumped off, because tanks can jump, apparently.
Yeah, suicide.
Jumped off in order to break them on purpose, mm-hmm. so that my engineer can go over and fix them. I feel way better about the tie,
mm-hmm.
than I ever would have felt about that win.
I agree, because honestly, this is a game of... So Infinity is a game of resource management. So if you think about that, you wasting a resource to game numbers is against the whole...
Yeah, fluff isn't rules.
Yeah, that's cool. You know, it's like, well, if you want to do this, I mean, if it's a loophole, that's fine with you. I have honor. I can't do that because I have honor. And to me, that's dishonorable. Like, yeah, just because something doesn't say something in the right way and you can exploit that for a win, I now want to beat you at your own game and beat you without doing that, because to me, it's more honorable and reputable because I'm not going to game the system. I do not like gaming the system. I am a firm believer of that. I think it's good in character building in life. Like,
yeah,
I play this game to have fun.
Like 3-4 weeks ago, my first F word ever on the entire show.
Yeah, like to me,
was about gaming the Wotan system.
Yeah, it's not my thing, man. Like,
as it turns out, Pano didn't care. I said the F word.
No, yeah,
they did it anyway.
Yeah, it's fine too, man. Like, there's no real, like, honestly, there's no. It's all about the narrative. And in tournaments, yeah, there's winners, but everybody's a winner if you're learning and having a good time, man. Like, I know that, like, it gets competitive. I'm a highly competitive person, but I don't let certain bullshit get in my way. Like, I just don't. Because I have a conscience, I have a set of guidelines that I live my life by, and I want everybody to enjoy themselves. That's my purpose. Like, hey, I am, like, the most positive person that you'll ever meet. And I want everybody to have fun. If I raffle stomp somebody, I feel bad for them. Cause I'm like, hey, like, what can I teach you to like learn? Like if I outplay you, like how can I make you better? Because I want everybody. I have the most fun when every order is like life or death. Like when there's a game where you're just like, oh my gosh, this is wire to the wire. It comes down to the last freaking roll and you pull it out or you lose. That's the most fun for me. The most fun for me because it was a battle of wits. Win, lose, or draw. Even if you lose that by one dice roll, you're like, I was one dice roll away.
So I know that we're going to get a bunch of, fluff isn't rules. The rules say you can. The rules say you can do it. So that while you're playing in a tournament, so anything goes and all of that stuff. I didn't feel comfortable trying to suicide a tractor mule and then fix it with my dozer to get the win.
I won't do that.
Because I could not figure out a way that made sense. Not lyrically.
It's just not your style, not the right man. Word. Like, just don't.
Make sense narratively. That's a word. It didn't make sense narratively for, like, why would that happen? Why would I? Doesn't make sense. And what doesn't make sense to the people that would do that is like, well, that's the only way you can win. You had the win. Why didn't you take the win? That doesn't make sense to me, right? So I understand the other point of view.
Yeah, you're right on that. On their point of view, it's like, just not my point of view.
Right, and
and I take pride of beating people without using that.
Why wouldn't you do that? It's in the rules. You can do it. It's not cheating.
Well, it's technically not in the rules.
How is it not in the rules? Can you climb?
Time out.
Can you jump?
Time out.
Do you take falling damage?
There's no
totally
one
in the
thing.
Rules.
So basically what they're saying is like, if I take falling damage and I hope that I pass all my armor rolls and not die, technically the rules, the way they're written, allow you to attempt it, but it's not in the rules. It allows you to attempt it within the rule set, but it's not in the rules.
We talked about it at dinner, and I said the easy fix, the easiest fix to remove this loophole of idiocy that people exploit is to say that falling damage may not be repaired by an engineer nor healed by a doctor or a paramedic.
Love it. Perfect. I like that. Put it in the rules.
Easy
I love
fix.
It. Yeah, because like if you fall off a building and you break both freaking legs, you can't fight.
Only way to...
You can't. You're going to be laying there. Or you land on your head like you said, Tom.
Yeah, like...
You're going to pull your blood... Well, he's in a coma, but we're gonna doctor him and he'll shoot things.
Yeah, we can give, okay. So this ridiculous. Guy who got shot, we're gonna pull the bullet out and we've got space age stuff that we can fill it with, like
that makes sense.
Liquiflesh 2000 by Mototronica, and then and we'll get him back in the fight. But you just jumped off a 2-story building and broke both of your femurs.
Technically, in the game, it's like a 6-story building. Six stories.
I can't fix you. I can fix you.
But
I'm gonna need some left legs. From an L host. That's
maybe a left and a right legs. falling damage is ridiculous.
Right. You broke. Good. Yeah,
he done.
The tractor mule jumps off of a building, crashes to the ground. Dozer walks up to it, it's like, I'm gonna need parts. Right?
Yeah, it's just ridiculous.
You seen the movie Fury?
There you go.
They had like 2 hours to try and fix a tank tread so they could be mobile. Just one tread. It didn't fall off a building. Blew off one tread, and they're like, Germans are coming. Not going to be able to fix that. This is a bunker now.
Yeah.
Falling damage can't be repaired or healed. Seems like an easy fix to me.
I like that. I like that. And for those of you who disagree, you're entitled to your opinion until they fix it. But letting you know, your friendly host, Kit Parcell, believes that is unhonorable and a crock of shit.
Well, whatever. So I wasn't going to do that.
My personal opinion. So Grant, it's my personal opinion.
Grant and
I'm allowed
I had
that.
Grant and I had a fun time.
Mm-hmm.
I had the coffee jitters real bad in that game, though. I was knocking stuff over.
Can I say one thing that you could do, though? Before you say coffee jitters, could you get your tractor mule? I'm doing some weird hand things that nobody can see. Could you get your tractor mule in close combat with anybody that's like halfway up the field?
No, no one was near it.
Damn it! Because that could have been your way out. Because yeah, they can't.
They dodge.
Can just not shoot.
Just dodge.
When you move into it, they would dodge, and then you would hit them with your close combat.
My electric pulse. As long as they dodge on a 7 or greater.
And then if they don't, then you just
it's electric pulse. They don't close combat.
I thought they had like a close combat of like 10. Don't electric pulse. You don't have to electric pulse. You can just close combat.
And they'll dodge.
Yeah, and then you hope you win. It's better than not doing anything.
And then
anything.
You still don't. It's the same thing as moving out with your Katyusha and firing on somebody, and they're like, yeah, I'll dodge.
Yeah, but if you get in the I thought they had a close combat. I don't know.
Like, refusing to damage it doesn't break the narrative for me.
Yeah.
Maybe they want to capture it later. No, or maybe it's I want to preserve myself. And so you dodge out of the way. That doesn't break the narrative. Running it up the wall of a building and then leaping off the top. Mm-hmm. However they leap, I don't even know how a tractor mule can jump. Mm-hmm. The other remotes, you know, they got the springy legs. Yeah. But, like, a tractor mule, how does it jump? And so, like, it doesn't make any sense. So
actually, tractor mules don't have electric poles.
Oh, they don't?
Nope. But you can have a close combat of 8.
Excuse me?
Yes.
And they'll dodge.
And if you hit them, yeah, but if you hit them, a lot of people
only have... Physique of 9?
Well, they do. But if you do close combat, you have your 8... They have their physique of 11. It's pretty much, it's close enough to try. And if you,
anyway,
if they
great
beat
game
you.
Anyway, great game against Grant Fetter, host of Personal Flash Paper. Mm. We tied 7-7 on Highly Classified, and we had the No Suicide Pact, and it was a good time. And I don't like it. And I heard plenty of stories that other people at the same tournament were doing the suicide to get the points.
And dumb.
I don't think that's a flaw with Highly Classified. I think it's a flaw with character. I think it's a flaw with a loophole in the rules that doesn't make any narrative sense. But, yeah. I'd rather play a different way than other people would rather play. So then game 5. Charles from St. Louis. I had run into him all weekend long and probably never remembered his name because I'm terrible at names. Indigo Jack is his, it's his war name. Indigo Jack is
like
his
that.
ITS name. And Charles was playing Neo Terra.
Mm-hmm.
And we were talking at lunch because we ate lunch together before the game, not knowing we were going to play each other. And then we show up and we're like, hey, we're playing each other. And at lunch, we were talking and like neither one of us had won a lieutenant role all weekend. And then we find out we're playing each other and we're like, oh, so it ends. One of us has to win.
Nice.
Yeah, so he won.
Oh.
Wait, no, I think I won and chose deployment. Yeah, I won and chose deployment. So he went first. It didn't matter. So Charles playing Neo Terra, and he had a couple Auxilia. He had a couple of Pathfinders. He had a Bulleteer Spitfire. He had a Fusilier Link team with HMG, Missile Launcher, and a couple of regulars, one of which is clearly Lieutenant. He had an Assault Hacker Locust with ODD.
Oof.
Yeah, I like those guys.
Yeah.
My Warcore killed that guy.
No way.
Yeah, we'll talk about that later.
Oh, man.
So I start playing with Charles, and Second roll of the game, he crits Ushi McNeil, who had, you know, I guess she got discovered and then reacted in ARO, but it was like boarding shotgun against a missile launcher.
Like she in set up short range?
She set up right near the missile launcher.
Oh, man.
And so the trauma doc discovered her from far away or whatever. Mm-hmm. And so she's revealed. She's right in front of the missile launcher. He shoots pistols, which is a smart thing.
Of course,
thing.
Yeah, that's what you do.
Smart deal.
Yeah.
And I, you know, shoot back with boarding shotgun.
Mm-hmm.
And he crit Ushia.
Oh, my God.
So Ushia is dead. So, cool. The very next order, he moves the Pathfinder out, and the Spetsnaz sniper crits the Pathfinder. So we're even.
Okay. That works.
He's like, oh, I didn't expect that. And from then on, we were not even.
No, I don't like to hear
that. At one point, I said to Charles, I was like, that is your seventh crit. And he goes,
no.
And he says, I know, I don't know what came over me. Because clearly, at the end, it's the fifth round. It's the fifth round of a five-round tournament. And I've only won one game and tied another and lost the other two.
Yeah.
We are not exactly the creme de la creme of this particular tournament.
Yeah, right.
And so I'm like, that's like the seventh crit you've had. He's like, I don't know what came over me.
He saved it all for that one game.
And he was a super super friendly, gregarious guy. Liked him a lot. Like
that's hilarious.
Totally low key.
Mm-hmm.
So it was a great game. Really enjoyed it. But didn't succeed at anything. You know, and it's the whole I've got four dice at 15s, you have mm-hmm. one dice at a six, and he rolls the six.
Oh, yeah.
And that was the whole game.
Oh, man. That is rough. So, we have all faced that at times and times, and it sucks.
So his cocky locust comes up to it's safe area. So there's four things you got to control at the end of the game.
Mm-hmm.
Moves his locust up to my closest one. Because I assume he feels like I'm killing everything. So I'm just going to. So he moves a locust up to my closest one, and my war core is nearby. And so he's controlling, you know, three of them. I'm going second, whatever.
Mm-hmm.
But there's a locust controlling my closest one. And so the war core moves, and there's a building in between them. So the war core is not mm-hmm. being seen. And the war core moves, and the war core is within 8 inches.
Okay.
That's when the locust found out that the war core was switch.
Oh! Well friggin' played, Mr. Thomas Shadle.
And switch blew out the locust's brain.
Oh, would you, Trinity?
And did I Trinity or did I Red Rum?
I was going to say Trinity or Red Rum.
I think I Red Rum because of the minus three.
Okay, that would make sense.
Trinity burst three is awesome, but the minus three burst two.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, I think I minus three'd him. And, yeah, so blew out his brains. So that was cool.
Nice.
And that was really my highlight of the game.
That's a really good way. That's an amazing way to use Switch. I never even thought about that. It's irregular.
Yep.
It's a war core. You don't even think about it. Damn, you just blew my mind, too. You literally just red-rummed me, too.
Why is that war core not on the edge of a building,
right?
AROing everything,
right?
Well, because it's a killer hacker. But yeah, he did really well and killed all my stuff. And I sent the antipodes across, right?
Mm-hmm.
And he succeeded at every attempted discover roll. So I'm halfway across the table, and I'm like, you know, maybe fail one discover roll, but so. Instead of piling into that Fusilier Link team, or at least one of them, I cut bait halfway across the table and assaulted the Pathfinder drone bot, who lost the close combat,
uh-huh.
but passed his armor roll, and I was in close combat with that for the rest of the game. So I guess I locked down those 20. 1 point or whatever it is.
Yeah.
Yeah, but no, super chill dude. And great game. Like I said, I couldn't have asked for five better opponents. Mm-hmm. I could have asked for a little bit better luck, I suppose, because the...
Dice gods weren't in your favor.
Yeah, like I said, just about the like the Spetsnaz with the... Yeah. I got 4 out of 15. You got 1 out of 6.
Yeah,
I
lost. Sucks, man.
Those are the positions I put myself in all weekend long and lost almost every time. And so that was disheartening. But everybody I played was super awesome and was super fun. So that's cool. And everybody's like, hey, people who blame dice just aren't good players. And I was like, no.
Sometimes, yeah, it sucks.
People who put themselves in bad probability situations are probably not good players.
Yeah.
The dice are just the
happens.
Dice. The dice are just the dice. So whatever.
Luckily, you were with... like you said, good players, because that's what it's all about, you know.
Okay,
like,
so we're at an hour 50.
Dang, we need to get out of here.
And so I've talked about all of the games, and so I need to quickly tell the world that TwinFinity Open was the most organized and best run tournament I have ever been a part of. And Sean Poschel knocked it out of the park.
Nice.
From the way he organized the prize distribution.
Mm-hmm.
No, you don't get to pick. We got, like, random draws. They're in your bag. Bring them up to the counter during the weekend. We're not going to have this long, drawn-out thing at the end of the ceremony. To how efficiently the results were collated and reported. For 71 players, there was one error the entire weekend long. It was fixed within 5 minutes.
Wow, that's amazing.
And so all the pairings were legit. And yeah, just, I mean, everything was so smooth. The cards for reporting results, every table had a card every turn. You both filled in one card. You each signed it to make sure it was legit.
Mm-hmm.
And you turn one thing in for one table.
Perfect.
And so they're not sorting through a billion things.
Yeah.
And he had a data entry guy typing all the stuff for him. And he had judges walking the floor. And he was a judge walking the floor. And just everything about it was the most organized, the best run, smoothest tournament. I don't care if he runs it for 8 people or 300 people. It's going to be a smooth, excellent event. And so if he kept to the time schedule, which I applaud him, and I wish more TOs at larger events would do this. I tried to do it last year at Arizona Armageddon. There's a hard dice down.
Yeah.
And there is a set break. Mm-hmm. And then you start the next round. Yep. And it's, you know, it's very Prussian. Ein, zwei. And it was, you know, and so everybody got 2 hours.
Mm-hmm.
So even if you're a little newer, there's a little cushion there for you to finish your game.
Yeah.
5 games over 2 days. You get 2 hours to finish, and then there's a half hour break in between.
I like that.
So if you got to use the restroom, you can hold it a little longer because you got a half hour break coming up.
Yeah.
If you want to get a coffee, you can probably not do it in the middle of your game and slow play your dude because you're up on victory points, like happened at Rumble. And, you know, so 2 hour rounds, half hour breaks, everything was strictly kept to time. It was so strictly kept to time, there was extra time on Sunday.
Nice.
So really well organized. Congratulations to Mr. Poschel and all of his helpers, especially the dude, I don't know his name, the dude who is doing the data entry, probably the most thankless job, and yet he's the one that had to see every single person at the tournament as they handed in cards. That dude putting in all the results into the computer. Mm-hmm. Joel Vaughn running around doing judging and stuff. Don Haney, judge painting, and old GW Golden Demon guy. And so what an excellent experience. What an excellently run tournament. More large event organizers should, you know, say, hey, Sean,
yeah, what you
how
doing?
Did you do that? Yeah,
exactly, right?
Because it was amazing. So, Sean, from the bottom of my heart, thank you so much for the weekend. It was amazing. You had 71 this year. I hope next year you are over 100. You deserve it. You should be the biggest tournament in the United States. It was fantastic. And thank you to Greg Strom and what's his name with the beard and the angst? Joel Vaughn. And to Moondoggy and to Tom and to Ginger Ninja and to Twiddle Tap. It's Grant Fetter. And
nice.
And to Charles.
Ginger Ninja's like my cousin's tagline, by the way.
James Chaveau from Indianapolis. To Will Thompson. To like Shane Everly, who won the thing. Congratulations nice. To Shane with his JSA winning the whole shebang.
What? With JSA.
Yeah, crushing it. Nice. And
love that.
All of the people that I met that I forgot your names and called you the wrong name and then you corrected me and I said, damn it. Yeah. Thank you to all those people because I'm awful at names and it's no sign of disrespect. It's just my brain doesn't work and I'm sorry. And so, yeah, thanks to everybody. Thanks to all the listeners that came up and said, hey, thank you so much for the podcast. Thanks for all you do for the community. I really enjoyed listening. All of those people, and there were a lot of them.
Good.
Really appreciate
that. That's awesome, man.
And finally got to meet Tor in...
Shawanchan.
In real life person, so that was awesome.
I'm bummed I couldn't do that.
And yeah, no, just everything was awesome. Everything was awesome. And so thank you so much. And... So apparently at 1:55:55, we don't have time for listener emails, which was supposed to be half of this episode.
Nope. But we got to get out of here like right now.
TwinFinity was
awesome. We're running out of bandwidth.
And you're awesome. And thank you so much. And good job, Sean. And good job, Minnesota, for being not totally awful. And Lewis, when you come back, I hope you make it back safe. You were an awesome roommate. Monlapis, thanks for staying with us. Enjoyed cuddling with you. wish you were softer. You were sort of stiff. And
didn't Lewis come back as Luis like Fuentes or some stuff like that?
it was a horrific ending to his weekend. And thanks to everybody. It was awesome. And hopefully we can provide people with half that much entertainment at Arizona Armageddon. Until next time, ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for listening. Thank you to our Patreon sponsors. And make sure you're out there supporting your local game stores.